First Presbyterian Church, family and friends. It is a pleasure to be with you this morning. I'll go ahead and admit it is Friday morning right after 11 a.m. And I know that you're probably and hopefully watching this together Sunday morning at 11 a.m. But we are excited that the Lord has given us the opportunity to do this very thing. That technology would be such a gift from His hand that we can come and we can somewhat gather together in worship. If you read our letter from the session a couple of nights ago, we understand, and we're not trying to make it feel like we are together on the Lord's Day perfectly. But much like a grandfather or grandmother loves to FaceTime their grandchildren, it brings some sort of joy to know that we can just see each other's face. And it makes our personal meetings all that much more sweeter. And so please know that we are indeed praying towards being together again on the Lord's Day. We're praying that this sanctuary that we are in right now will be filled with the saints very soon, Lord willing. But for now, here is how we are going to worship. And it's going to be a sweet time of fellowship with our Lord as we worship Him together. Of course, there are a few people that we need to thank before we even enter into worship for letting or allowing or enabling this to be a success. And first, this is our guest organist, Jackson Stone. Jackson's a local high school student here, and we are so thankful that he is here to share his talents with us and with the Lord. Youth Director Zach is up in the sound booth and running our sound and our video recording, and so we thank him. And then ruling elders Jim Atkins and Kay McGirt are here, along with Kay's son Mark. And so Kay and Jim are going to be assisting us in worship while leading us in prayer. Let me again remind you that the session's monitoring all of these new updates that are coming out seemingly daily. And we are praying on hopefully being able to restore some normalcy to our church activities. And we hope that you would pray for us as well as we meet together. Also, if you are in need during this time, please do not hesitate to call your care group leaders or the church office. Again, those church office hours are Monday through Thursday, 8 a.m. To 2 p.m. Our God calls us to worship from His Word. Psalm 46, reading verses 1 through 3 and 10 and 11. Of course, you can see that text there in your bulletin, and I hope you'll follow along with us as you worship. God is our refuge and strength, the very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. In times of uncertainty and chaos, our God is indeed a very present help in time of trouble, and that is why we worship on the Lord's Day together. And so let us sing hymn number 55 if you have a Trinity hymnal at home. But if you do not, those hymn texts are there for you in your church email. And so please pull that bulletin up and let's sing together. To God be the glory.
Lord Jesus, how we thank Thee and praise Thee for the privilege of coming to the mercy seat to cry out to Thee, to pour out the Holy Ghost here in our worship service. Make Thy presence ever so real, near and far, as this message goes forth. We ask, Lord, that it'll go forth in the power of the Holy Spirit, that folks will be touched, that any that are hearing it without Christ, that today would be the day of salvation. And for our dear flock, we ask, Lord, to bless it to each and every one, encourage them, strengthen them, fit and furnish them to do the work of the ministry. And we thank Thee for so many opportunities in the midst of the storm. We know we serve the one who calms the storm, and we ask Thee, Lord, to teach us to pray as You taught Your disciples. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Church, if you'll take those bulletins again and see that we're going to recite together the Apostles' Creed. And we know that this is an ancient creed given to us by the history of the church and throughout the history of the church. And on this day, so many are gathered in their home or in their worship spaces, and they are going to confess this same thing alongside with us. And so as you are meeting with us at home, we ask the question still, Christian, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we continue in our worship, if you'll take those hymn sheets out again, we're going to sing, We Praise You, O God, Our Redeemer, Creator. If you have a Trinity hymnal at home, that's on page 97.
Let's pray. Father, we do thank You and praise You for the great privilege and opportunity that You've given us to even understand a bit more of what some of the early church went through when we read in Scripture when it speaks of the church in Thy house. Lord, we know that today is the day that we can worship you, the God, the creator of heaven and earth. We ask, Father, that you would help us to do that each and every day. Lord, we do thank you for the opportunity that we have to stand upon the promises that are given to us in Scripture, to trust in the Lord with all our heart, to lean not on our own understanding in all of our ways. Acknowledge him, and he'll direct our path. Lord, we're reminded of the psalmist when he declared that the foundations be destroyed. What can the righteous do? And we know that we're challenged to be righteous in our living. And that's the thing we can do, is to be righteous and look to you as the author and finisher of our faith. We ask, Father, that you would be with our leadership. We thank you for this opportunity that we have to worship. We thank you for our Pastor Matt and Zach. We pray for their families. I ask that you would continue to watch over them, strengthen them, anoint the ministries that you've gifted them with and the heart that they have to minister to us and to guide and direct us. Give wisdom and discernment to the officers in our church. Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit will go before us, guide us and direct us. We do pray for our medical professionals and those who are in our area, literally nationwide or worldwide. We ask, Father, that you would place a hedge of protection about them and that they would know your wisdom and your discernment beyond their years, beyond their training. And, Lord, we pray for an end for this virus and the things that are going on. Lord, we know that you can do all things and that, Father, we ask that you would, above all things, be glorified in and through these opportunities. Lord, we come to you lifting up those within our congregation who are, need your touch, who need your strength. We ask, Lord, that you would go before them and guide them and direct them. Give the doctors and nurses wisdom and discernment as they minister to them. We pray for your graces to be poured out upon those who are sick and in need of your tender care. We ask, Father, for your healing mercies in thy time and pray that above all things that your Holy Spirit will be glorified in and through them and strengthen the loved ones as they minister to them. Lord, we lift up our elected officials and those who are in leadership positions within our state and nation. We pray, Father, that you would guide them and direct them in and through the counselors that you've raised up. Lord, help them to look to you as the author and finisher of their faith. And pray, Father, that they would we would see a great turning, a great revival in our land. Lord, we ask for an outpouring of thy Spirit upon our pastor now as he breaks the bread of life, as we look into your word and dig deep into that word. We ask, Father, for your grace to be poured out upon us. And, Lord, above all things, that we would live the cross of Christ so large that the world would not misunderstand whose we are and whom we serve. Lord, help us to be reminded that you've not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Time for us to turn our attention to the Word of God, and so if you will take your Bibles and open with me to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, starting there in verse 18 and reading through verse 1 of chapter 4. Colossians chapter 3, verse 18, reading through verse 1. Of chapter 4. If you've been with us as we've been journeying through this letter to the Colossians, I think this is our 22nd sermon in this letter from Paul to the church at Colossae. You probably remember that all throughout the beginning of his letter, he has unpacked for us what it means to be united to Christ. He has unpacked for us what it means to be rooted in him and living in him. And then he seems to take a corner, so to speak, as he so often does, and he begins to unpack that truth. He takes the gospel truth that he has presented, and he begins to apply that doctrinal truth. He begins to tell us what it means, what it changes in the life of a Christian. He takes those indicatives, here you are in Christ Jesus, and he makes it an imperative, now here is how you are to live. If you were with us last Sunday evening, even I gave a little bit of a shout out to our youth Sunday school curriculum that's called the So What series, produced by the Great Commission Publications. And I'm going to shamelessly give it a plug again, because this is exactly how they write that youth curriculum. They'll begin to unpack the doctrinal truth of the scriptures. And then they'll ask the question, so what? What does it change? Why does it matter? And that's exactly what Paul is doing here in verses 18 through the rest of chapter 3 into the beginning of chapter 4. He has turned that corner, like we already said, and he has said, if you have been raised with Christ, showing us our union with him, here is how you are to live. And so as we look at this passage this morning, we want to remember that we are looking at imperatives, that Paul here is showing us how the gospel impacts that ordinary Christian living, the everyday life of the Christian. The gospel impacts those things, and how is that daily life to look? And so let's turn our attention to the Word of God, but before we do, let us pray that he would give us the ears to hear. Father in heaven, we know that we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. And so we come paying attention to the words that you would have to speak to us this morning. In your providence, you have guided us all the way to chapter 3, verse 18 of the Colossian letter. We had no clue that this is where we would be when we journeyed or started this journey through this letter to the church at Colossae. But, oh Lord, you did. And so let us take these words, let us take these truths, and let us apply it to our lives as we engage a world that is chaos, as we engage a world that is full of anxiety, as we engage a world that is dark and needs the light of Christ. Oh Lord, let this spur us on to be that light that Christ has asked us to be in our daily, ordinary living. As fathers and mothers, as husbands and wives, as bosses and co-workers, oh Lord, give us the ability, just as Kay prayed, to live the cross so large that no one would misunderstand whose we are. And so let this impact our daily life, and let us show that we are children of the Most High. Speak to us now, we pray. Send your Spirit to give us those ears to hear. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. People of God, hear the word of God. Wives, submit to your husbands as it is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by the way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily, as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Jesus Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your bondservants justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God remains forever and ever. Let me remind you a little bit about where we have been. We know through Paul's letter that the Colossian church is in a little bit of turmoil. It's in a little bit of chaos because false teachers have slithered their way into the ranks, and they have begun to preach a gospel plus something else. They began to preach a message that we need more than Christ. We need more than Jesus. And so they have added, haven't they? They have added all of these extra ways that you are to live, these legalistic standards, so to speak. Or they have added to the worship of God's people. They say you must worship angels. You must have these massive spiritual experiences. And Paul has put all of those things to rest, and he has wrote towards all of those things. He has wrote with compassion, yet sternly, to a church that is split wide open, probably, looking for which way which way to look, and he has said, here is Christ, and you need nothing more, and you are united to him in his death and in his resurrection. You are united to him, and therefore that impacts the way that you live. And it's so intriguing to me because Paul turns his attention to the daily life of the Christian believer. In a city that is chaotic in Colossae, in a church that is drama-filled and split wide open, he begins to write that the way that we conduct our daily life is a testimony to the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. And it matters. It matters. It matters the way that we live throughout the entire week. It matters the way that we live in our homes. It matters the way that we live and conduct ourselves in our workplaces. It matters how we love our wives and how our wives respect their husbands. This all matters within the life of the church. And this morning, in God's providence, we're confronted with these words. And you think, well, Matt, don't you have a word for us about the coronavirus? Well, I sure do. God has instructed us on this Lord's Day morning to live a life every day like you are living it for the glory of the Lord. The way that we show ourselves to be Christians in our marriages, the way that we show ourselves to be Christians in our homes, the way that we show ourselves to be Christians in our workplaces, the way that we even show ourselves to be Christians in the world matters, especially in a society, in a community, in a church that is feeling the weight of all of these anxieties and all of this chaos that has surrounded us these past couple of weeks. But also, let me remind you that the chaos hasn't just started a few weeks ago, because our world has been rapidly changing. It's been rapidly changing. You know, the world, the society that we live in today, we would have never dreamed it would be the society that we lived in 10 years ago. The way that the world has redefined marriage, the way that the world has redefined the family, the way that the world has redefined society. It's amazing how quickly all of these things have changed, how quickly all of these things have come upon us, and it's probably not going to get better anytime soon. And this passage that we have before us challenges us, doesn't it? In a society that has redefined all of these things, in a society that is chaotic, in a society that has changed the rules, so to speak, we are to live in honor and in glory of Christ Jesus. You know, one of the things that the world has quickly began to try to teach us is that somehow, some way, we are all the same. But here it's very clear, isn't it? Through Paul's writings, inspired by the Holy Spirit, he is telling us that as Christians, we have different callings. We have different roles within our society. And according to those roles and those callings that the Lord has gifted us, we are to conduct ourselves in certain ways. If you're a wife, you are to conduct yourself in a certain way. If you're a husband, if you're a father, you are to live out the gospel in a certain way. If you're a manager or a boss or a business owner, if you're just a simple employee, so to speak, that the gospel message impacts the way that we live. And so Paul writes to these people. He knows, just like our church, he knows that the Colossian church is made up of all of these people who have come together from all sorts of walks of life, and they have come together in the beauty of the church, and they are submitting themselves to the preaching of the word and to the teaching of the apostle. And so he begins to unpack for us the way the gospel impacts us in our marriages, in our homes, in our workplaces, and in our world. Of course, there in your bulletin, you see those 4 points, don't you? And you can follow along with us with that outline. The first one there is, of course, the Christian in the marriage. The Christian in the marriage. We were taught in preaching class that there's a way to wake up your people as they are inevitably beginning to fall asleep during your sermon. One is to pop the pulpit a couple of times. Another one is to say the word submission. We know that this word is a little bit of what we would call a trigger word, so to speak. It might not be exactly politically correct, yet we are here. And the Word of God tells us that our wives should be submitting themselves to their husbands. Now, what does that mean? I actually think that one commentator defines it quite well. He says, submission refers to a wife's divine calling to honor and affirm her husband's leadership and to help him carry it out through her gifts. It's not an absolute surrender of her will. Rather, it's her disposition to yield to her husband's guidance and her inclination to follow his leadership. I think that's exactly what Paul is talking about here. Paul is a champion of women in the life of the church. He is a champion of women within the roles of society and the roles of the home, yet he quickly reminds you that the way that Christ has established the home place is for that husband to be the leader, the spiritual leader. And so he tells her, you must submit to him in the Lord. It is fitting for you to submit to him in the Lord. It's right there in verse 18. It's not an absolute surrender of the wife's will, but it is her humbling herself before him, recognizing him as the leader and following his leadership. One of the things that Paul says here as a qualifying statement at the end of verse 18 is, as it is fitting in the Lord. And so, wives, pay attention to that phrase, because he's saying, don't follow your husbands into sin. And he's actually challenging husbands, do not lead your wife into sin. Lead them in the ways of the Lord. Lead them in the ways that the Lord has established you to lead them in. Of course, we know Ephesians chapter 5, don't we, where Paul's expanding this idea even more, and he says, husbands, love your wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one has ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Notice there that same tag is given in Ephesians 5 and here in Colossians 3, verse 18. That wives are to submit themselves to their husband as long as he is bringing her up, as he is encouraging her, as he is training her, as he is sanctifying her according to the word of the Lord. Now, we go all the way back to Genesis chapter 3, don't we? And in Genesis chapter 3, as Adam and Eve introduced sin into the world by eating of the forbidden fruit, remember there that God begins to hand down the judgment against their sin. And he begins to look at Eve and he tells her, you'll have pain during childbearing, but you'll also desire leadership over your husband. And so what Paul is saying here is revolutionary, because it goes against the sin that has tainted us. Those desires of that leadership that the wife desires. And he says, you must put that away. You must put away the idea that you could be over your husband, but you must humbly submit yourself to him as it is fitting in the Lord. And then he turns his attention to husbands in verse 19. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. You know, that phrase in Ephesians 5 is one of the ones that stick out to us so often. Ephesians 5, husbands, love your wife as Christ loves the church. And I remember many years ago when I first started at the church, I was helping Charlie Lee out in the yard fix a couple of sprinkler heads. And we worked for 15 minutes, let me be honest. We worked for 15 minutes and then we would take a break and we would sit on the landscaping benches outside. And I remember vividly one morning we were working on these sprinkler heads and we began to sit down and to talk, and he would always ask me about Beth, who I was even just dating then. And he would always ask me, Matt, do you intend to marry Beth? And of course, Mr. Charlie, I love Beth. Do you love Beth like Christ loves the church? And I would say, well, Mr. Charlie, I'm trying. And he would always sit back, trying, brother, that's your call to love her as Christ loved the church. We cannot just try, we must do it. And that is the call before us, isn't it? In verse 19, husbands, to love your wife just like Christ loved the church. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church, and Christ loves nothing more than his church. Christ loves nothing more than his bride. And you say, well, Matt, how do you know that Christ loves nothing more than his bride? Well, let me tell you that he gave up the blessings and the riches of heaven for his bride. He left the glories of heaven for his bride. He took on flesh for his bride. He was a king, yet was born in a lowly manger for his bride. He was threatened and arrested and set quietly through a joke of a trial for his bride. He was beaten, stripped, slapped, spit upon, speared, nailed, pierced, and crowned with a crown of thorns for his bride. That's how much he loves his bride. And the command for us here is to love our wives, husbands, in exactly the same way. But he continues, and do not be harsh with them, he says. Now, it's always intriguing when Paul writes something of the sorts here, when he gives us a little tag, because he's trying to make you realize something. And I think that Paul is writing this little tagline there in verse 19 because he knows that our natural inclination is to be harsh. Our sinful taintedness is to be harsh. And so we are to prize our wives like treasure. And we never mistreat our treasure, do we? But we are to prize our wives, not as a trophy, but as a valuable treasure, a valuable gift from the Lord. That's exactly how we are to love our wife, because she is a blessing, a gift from the Lord to be treasured and to be loved on and to be enjoyed. The Christian in the marriage. And then Paul begins to pan out a little bit in his exhortation here. He begins to talk about the family. That's our second point, a Christian in the family. Look there at verse 20 if you still have your Bibles open. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Now, here's an opportunity for us, I believe. Just as husbands are to love their wife as Christ loved the church, they are modeling Christ's love for the church. Here it is that children can model Christ's obedience to his heavenly Father. And it doesn't need much explaining, does it? This is a very simple command from the Apostle Paul. Obey your parents in everything. Obey your parents in everything. Obey the first time in everything. You know, this command that Paul writes here is actually quite simple. Obey your parents, and when you do, you please the Lord. And on the flip side of that, when you don't, it displeases the Lord. Obey your parents. Obey your parents the first time. Obey your parents in everything, children. Because delayed obedience is disobedience. You know, we've been there, haven't we? We've all grown up with parents, and we have, many of us have children, and we know kind of the severity that the home place takes when you ask your child to do something and it comes to be about 9 o'clock in the evening and you haven't done it yet. That was me. That was my mantra growing up. My parents would ask me to do something, and for some reason I thought I had the entire day to do it. But I always remember when I was dating Beth and we were spending a lot of time at her house with her family, her parents would ask her little brother, "Now, we need you to take out the trash." And lunchtime came. "Hey, remember that trash." Dinner time came. "Why haven't you taken out the trash?" Bedtime came. "You're going to take out that trash before you get a spanking." And I don't know why in the world you would be so hard on me, because you're disobeying. And that's exactly what Paul wants you to see, that we are to obey our parents in everything. Obey our parents the first time they ask, because it is pleasing to the Lord for you to obey that father and that mother that God has given to you. Obey your parents. And then he moves on, doesn't he? He goes back to the man. Now, admittedly, I know that when I said submission, that wives should submit to their husbands, the husbands grabbed a pen off the coffee table and looked at their wives and said, "It's time for you to take good notes this morning." But then all of a sudden, the wife handed the pen to the husband, said, "You need to take good notes." Well, you can hand that pen back to your husband, because Paul again starts addressing the man in the family again, and he's talking about the fathers. Look back there at verse 21. "Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged." Again, why has Paul given us this exhortation? Well, I think it's because our natural inclination is to provoke our children. Because we'll be the first one to admit, I'll be the first one to admit, fathering children, even though mine are 2 and 9 months, is a struggle. It comes with many frustrations. It comes with a lot of suffering, a lot of joys, but a lot of, quote unquote, I get it, suffering. And so Paul wants you to understand, fathers, I know that you're going to grow in your frustration as you're raising your children. I know it's going to be easy to provoke them. Put that sin inclination away, because you do not want your children to become discouraged. You say, "Well, Matt, how do I discourage my children? How do I provoke them?" I think there's a few ways here, and I think that first one is just simply discouragement. You know, there are many men who, if you start breaking down their hard outer shell, they begin to tell you that they never heard their father tell them that they did a good job on anything. And so they begin to self-doubt. They begin to just attempt to do everything to the best of their ability. And if they can't do it perfectly, they think it's garbage and rubbish. And you start asking them, "Well, you did a fine job. Why are you striving to perfection?" "Well, you know, I just can never live up to my father. He always told me that I did a poor job on everything." I think that's something that Paul's talking about here. Don't be a discouragement to them. I think another way that he's talking about this provoking our children is really a lack of affection. You know, one of the things that we think so often is that our children need this tough love. but to show our children that we love them and we care for them, especially when we have young children. We need to hug them and to kiss them and to hold them when they want to be held, and to cuddle with them and read to them and pray with them and all of these things to show them our affection, that show them that we truly, truly love them. Another way we can provoke them is criticism, I think. One psychologist gets it so right. He says, the child who lives with criticism does not learn responsibility. He learns only to condemn himself and find fault with others. He learns to doubt his own judgment, disparage his own ability, distrust everybody. Above all, he learns to live with continual expectation of impending doom. And I don't think there's any father who would say, that's how I want my child to live, yet we continue to criticize them. And I know it sounds a little funny, but we need to create a home that is a positive and an uplifting place. We need to build up our children as they grow in the Lord and grow in their physical bodies and grow in their trades and talents. We need to encourage them. And we never need to play favorites. One of the things that's so easy is to remind your son or your daughter that they're not your other son or daughter. You know, I surely wish you were like Gerald or like Jenny. You know, they do their homework and they're really good at it and they don't need help with their multiplication tables. Why do you need so much help? You know, your brother or your sister, they clean their room and they do it even without me asking. Why can't you be like them? And do you see the atmosphere that you are creating when you're playing favorites? Well, Paul says, don't do these things. Don't provoke your children. They will become discouraged. Encourage them. Promote them. Love them well. That's what he's saying in the Christian home. And then he turns to that third point and he starts talking about the Christian workplace, or the Christian in the workplace. If you look there, verse 22, bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by the way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Now, I could probably go on for another hour talking about the Roman world and bondservants and masters. And let me just tell you this, that the slavery that's being talked about here in Colossians chapter 3 is not the slavery of the Deep South in the 1800s. This is a relationship of willing servanthood. It's much like workers and co-workers and bosses and employees within our society today. These bondservants had great responsibilities of running houses and running businesses. And what we have here is Paul saying to those employees, obey your bosses. Obey your managers, not to be people pleasers, not to be the eye candy of the store or the workplace, but in fear of the Lord, as you're working for the Lord. I love verse 23. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men. That's exactly what he's saying here. It is a word to us as workers that we as Christians, we as Christian employees need to work hard, need to labor well. And it's not so that we can get all these pats on the back. It's not that we can receive the glory, but they can say that there is someone else that he is working for far beyond me. And they're right. You're working to be pleasing in the eyes of your Savior. You're working to please not men, but to please the Lord. We hear that term, don't we? This Christian work ethic. That's what we should keep in mind. That's what we should be doing. When we are working, we are representing our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, even as we go into the workplace, even as we are encouraged to work well. We are working and we are doing for the glory of God. And then in verse 1 of of chapter 4, he goes from employees to employers, the bosses, the managers, the business owners. Masters, treat your bondservants. Bosses, treat your employees justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. So for any of you who manage people or run a business or anything like that, there's a word to you here, and that's to be fair. To be fair to those employees that God has gifted you for a season, to be a good steward of them, to treat them well. And that's a word that I think we all need to keep in mind and that we need to remember, that we have a master in heaven that is fair to us in Christ Jesus, beyond fair to us in Christ Jesus, gracious and merciful and compassionate to us in Christ Jesus. And just like our master in heaven, we need to treat our employees, our people well. You know, that brings up our fourth and final point, doesn't it? Because this text before us walks us through that ordinary Christian life. This text before us and implores us to live lives worthy of our calling as Christians. If you go all the way back to verse 1 of chapter 3, if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. That's exactly the point that Paul is making. That as we conduct ourselves in our ordinary daily Christian life, we are showing ourselves as faithful. We are showing ourselves as those who seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. We are to live lives that are glorifying to the Father through Jesus Christ the Son. To Him be the glory and the glory alone in our marriages, in our homes, in our workplaces, in our world. And if we will do this, beloved, one of the things that is so sure to me in the text is that we will look different than the world around us. That if we will be Christians in all areas of our life, living our lives to the glory of God, living our lives, seeking the things that are above where Christ is, we will look different from the world because we will be imitating, we will be modeling Jesus for them. And you know, that's what the call of the Christian life is. Put on Christ as His chosen children and wear Him proudly. And wear Him in a world that you can show Him and that people will say, boy, is He different. And we are, because we are living in the righteousness of Christ. And notice here that living in the righteousness of Christ is not a radical call. It's an ordinary call. Be good husbands and wives. Be good fathers and mothers. Be good children. Be good employees, be good employers, knowing that we are modeling Jesus and being a witness of Christ in the world around us. And you know, what a better time to do such a thing. What a great opportunity God has given us in the midst of this pandemic called the novel coronavirus, that we can go into a world that is chaos, that we can go into a world that's disorganized, that we can go into a world that has nothing figured out, it seems, and we can be a stable force within our community. We can model Jesus to our community. And so, beloved, while you're quarantined at home, while you've become an impromptu homeschool teacher, as you work through hard decisions at your workplaces, as you wait in long lines at grocery stores searching for toilet paper, as you engage an anxious world, a fearful world, would you model Christ? Would you model Christ in all areas of your life? Would you show us Jesus in the midst of the ordinary, in the midst of your daily life? Will you do it? And will you ask Him that you can do it all the more? Let us pray to that end together. Father in heaven, we do thank you for the opportunity to come to your word. We thank you for the opportunity for it to convict us and to confront us and to change us and to mold us and to encourage us and for it to give us hope. And so, Father, as we come in response to the word, would you continue to let this message ring true in our ears, and would it change the way? Would it encourage us in the way that we love our spouse, we love our children, we love our co-workers, and we love this world? Father, there is nothing more than to love you with all of our being and to love our neighbor as ourself. And as we do so, let us model Jesus, who is the perfect picture of love and the perfect picture of obedience and the perfect picture of care. Let us model him and let that be a light into the dark places. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing one more time in response to the preaching of the word. Leaning on the everlasting arms. If you have a Trinity hymnal at home, that's 616. Let's sing together. Fellowship. Thank you for joining us this morning, and we hope that this time of worship has been encouraging to you. We hope that you will be in touch with us throughout this week as we continue our labors in the church office, and please know that you will indeed hear from us. And now, let's receive the Lord's blessing through his word. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's sing the doxology together.